We gather knowing that surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Will you stand and join me?
Listen to Schmaltz too. pre-orders, please come see me at the back table. If you didn't pre-order, no worries. We have plenty left over. There are 12 cards in each box for $20. I'll be at the back of the church if you're interested. Thank you.
That was Leslie. And now Carol Jameson.
Thank you. are mystified. We, the church, are given the final parable in Matthew's gospel to see how the Son of Man, the King, the Shepherd, will respond to the nations. Judgment means that things will be set right, but here it also means more. The community of faith is given a preview of what is to come, and in the process, now to see outsiders, the nations, in a different light. God will remember their suffering and persecution. God will also remember the kindness, the mercy, the love from those whom they might think are enemies to them, to the church, to the least of these.
Oh.
once again, I am left lonely. This will not be. Thank you, Sandra Scrooge. This morning, I was thinking about my time yesterday serving at the soup kitchen with our youth of Genesis and St. Manuel, or evangelism, I'm sorry. And it reminded me of the story I want to read you guys. I met him on the train, and before long, I felt I knew him. I felt I could trust him. He was an education, learning for life, he called it. I said I was interested in education, too, and so he invited me to come with him to where he taught and learned. It was off the main road near the fire station. It didn't look like a school. Walked in the door of a second-hand shop, and going through the back, came to a big room with a lot of people in it. He stood and looked around. In the corner was an old man with a white stick, and beside him sat a girl reading him the newspaper. Nice to see young folk helping the blind, I said. Oh, he replied. He's actually teaching her how to see. Across the floor in the direction of the toilets came a wheelchair. A paraplegic boy of 18 sat in it, and a boy the same age pushed it. It's great when friends help each other, I said. Yes, he replied. The boy in the chair is teaching the other how to walk. An old woman lay in a bed at the bottom of the room. She was covered with open sores. A woman, much her junior, was dressing her wounds. Is she a nurse? I asked. Yes, he replied. The old woman is a nurse. She's teaching the other how to care. Seated around a table were a group of young couples. A doctor in a white coat was talking to them about power. He spoke slowly and used sign language with his hands. I think it's only fair that deaf people should know about these things, I said. But they do know about these things, my friend replied. They are teaching the doctor how to listen. And then I saw a woman on a respirator breathing slowly. These were her last breaths. And around her were her friends, smoothing her brow, holding her hands. It's not good to die alone, I said. That's right, he replied. But she's not dying alone. She's teaching the others how to live. Confused and not knowing what to say, I suggested that we sit down. After a while, I felt I could speak. Seeing all of this, I said, I want to pray. I want to thank God that I have all of my faculties. I now realize how much I can help. Before I could say more, he looked me straight in the face and said, I don't want to upset your devotional life, but I hope you would also pray to know your own need. And I hope you will never be afraid to be touched by the need. Let's pray. God, so often we think that we are not believers. So often we believe that we fully functioning humans, those of us who have homes and all of our faculties and heat and air and cars and jobs, we believe that we are sent to help others. And that's true. God, help us to understand that we are also in need. help us to understand that we still have much to learn in the course of being your church. We love you. Amen. All right, now we can go hang out with Miss Cindy for Children's Church.
Every month we do some planning and welcome new members into the church. Today's the last Sunday of the church year, and people have come and gone and all sorts of stuff, and so I would like to put no names in the bulletin this week, so I would like to invite anyone who is interested in joining the church right now to come forward, and if there's no one, there's no one. If there's 20, there's 20. Don't we have one? This is Brian. Brian, if you want to come up, you can. Can you introduce yourself?
My name is Brian. My last name is Steele. I live here in New Albany over on Dewey Street behind the shirt factory. And I've been coming to St. Mark's when they had the soup kitchen and clothes closet. And about the last 6 to 8 months, I've been coming to church.
I'm Nancy Winker, and my husband and I both work for RJ. They've been coming here for over a year, and recently decided that we want to be our church home.
Don't go away. We begin each worship service with the words, no matter who you are or where you are in life's journey, we welcome you. We mean these words as all who enter our doors are welcomed with great joy. We welcome in this day people who have walked their journey in different and varied places. We are honored that they have chosen to continue their faith walk with us, and we celebrate their presence in our midst. So we ask you today, do you desire to walk with us in your journey of faith as active members of this congregation, St. Mark's United Church of Christ? If so, please say, we so desire with God's help. Do you promise to join with us in our common worship and our service to those around us as we strive to live out our faith in Jesus Christ? We promise with the help of God.
We promise with the help of God.
Do you promise to join with us to always be welcoming and to share the common spirit of the words, no matter who you are or where you are in life's journey, you are welcome here. We promise with the help of God.
We promise with the help of God.
Let us as a congregation welcome those who are joining with us this day.
Will answer him, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you? And the king will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who were members of my family, you did it to me. Then he will say to those at his left hand, you that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. And I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. Then they also will answer, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you? Then he will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. May the word of the Lord be blessed.
Churches are not going to survive the next decade. And what we are experiencing in the UCC is also happening in Lutheran churches, United Methodist churches, Presbyterian churches, the Disciples of Christ, etc. The Roman Catholic Church has experienced a massive decline. They lack priests and people, and many churches are closing because they no longer have the resources, the priests, or the people to keep them open. So it's forcing churches right now in a very dramatic way to ask themselves the question, why are we here? And specifically, we ask ourselves the question, why is St. Mark's United Church of Christ in downtown New Albany in existence? And it's not just to worship God, because all churches do that. And it's not just to educate people in the Christian faith, because all churches do that. And it's not just to care and support each other in a congregation. All churches do that. We can debate with each other how well we do it or other churches do it, but all churches foundationally do those three things. So why are we here if beyond that? This church was founded in the year 1837 by first German immigrants, and it had a very specific reason to exist. It was founded to serve the Protestant German immigrants who were settling in New Albany. The church was not yet called St. Mark's. It saw itself as a Lutheran church, an evangelical church being the original name of what Martin Luther called his movement, and a Reformed church. It was a church of diverse beliefs with one common thread. The common thread being all the people were German. If you went to a church meal back in those days, it was always going to be German food. The worship services were in German, and the church had a very strong identity of being German. In the year 2017, this is no longer the case. We continue to have the diverse beliefs of our predecessors. One of the things I have often thought is it's built right into the DNA of these walls. Where two or three are gathered, there'll be four or five opinions. That has not changed. We have diverse beliefs, but not everyone is German. When you have a pastor whose last name ends with a vowel, he is certainly not German. I have no idea what the ethnic makeup of this church is right now, but it's not really relevant any longer. We do everything in English except singing one verse of Silent Night in German on Christmas Eve. Meals can be anything, and most of us, no matter what our ethnic backgrounds, see ourselves first and foremost, not as German or Italian or Irish or English, but as Americans. So why are we here? To me, the answer to the question is the story of a church. And most specifically, it's the story of this church. And after a lot of thoughts and prayers, I come up with an idea that speaks to me. You may not agree with me because this would not be our church if everybody agreed with me, but it's my thought. Among non-church-growing people, there are several groups. There are a group of people called nuns, not the Roman Catholic sisters. But the nuns are the people with no religious affiliation. Many of them will label themselves spiritual but not religious. And while we do reach out and work and welcome nuns, many people have gone from being nuns to being members of St. Mark's, but they are not the foundational reason we exist. There are the duns. The duns are the people who did go to church, were often very involved with the church, and for some reason raised their arms and said, I'm done. These are the people who have given up on religion, sometimes God, but the one thing they're done with church. We welcome them, but rarely see them. I think we exist for a third group, and the third group I'm going to call the refugees. And before you get excited, I'm not talking about immigration and refugees or political conversations. That's a whole different topic. I'm referring specifically to two types of refugees, societal refugees and spiritual refugees. Societal refugees are the poor and displaced in society. These are people we serve at our soup kitchen, our clothes closet, our health fair, white flag, repair fair, mission trips, whatever. They are refugees because in many communities, people are not even aware that these people exist or unwilling to acknowledge these people exist. I've heard a large number of people tell me, not from this church, but from other places, that there really aren't very many poor people in New Albany. They've never really seen poor people in New Albany. If you have ever worked at soup kitchen or clothes closet or repair fair, are there poor people in New Albany?
Yes.
Are there a lot of them?
Yes.
Okay. They are societal refugees. And these are the people who come here for help because they need help. And they're welcome here. They're part of the reason we exist. The second are the spiritual refugees. These are people who identify themselves as Christians. People of faith who feel like they've been abandoned by organized Christianity. And in many cases, they have been. They are the people who drive through town and see church after church after church, and for a variety of reasons, do not feel welcome in those churches. Many of the churches do not allow divorced people to be a part of the life of the church in its fullness. Some exclude people from sacraments if they get divorced and remarry. Many churches will not officiate at weddings of people who have been divorced. Many divorced people feel like they are spiritual refugees. Many churches do not allow women in leadership positions. Women, often well-educated and brilliant and talented, are not allowed to preach or teach. Many of these women feel like they are refugees. Many gay people feel like they are refugees because they have been banned from churches or banned from leadership or anything else. Many gay people feel like they are refugees. Many women who have been violently abused at home, they come and seek help at their church, and they are chastised for making their husbands angry and told to go back. Many don't. And when it comes to church, many of these women say that they are refugees. There is a church in town that invites refugees. There is a church in town that actively seeks and invites and welcomes refugees. One church has on its bell tower, no matter who you are or where you are in life's journey, you are welcome here. Does anybody know what church has that on their church? I don't overwhelm you. It's on our church. And if you did, you know, and if most churches, if you know how I started, sir, no matter who you are or where you are in life's journey, wouldn't say that because they wouldn't really know the answer to that. Take note of what Jesus has to say. Matthew 25. Amazing passage. Churches exist to serve God and God's people. And that is pretty much it. Churches exist to serve God and God's people. Jesus very specifically says, explicitly with no subtlety, that the way we serve God is by serving God's people. Whenever we serve God's people, we are serving God. Jesus is telling us that this is the core of our existence. This is, according to Jesus, the ultimate test of salvation. When we serve the least of God's people, when we serve the refugees, we serve God. And that, to me, is why we exist. That is our story. The words on our bell tower tell the societal refugees that they are welcome here, and we will feed them, we will clothe them, we will stay up at night with them in a shelter, we will love them, and we will ask for nothing in return. The words on the bell tower tell the people, tell the spiritual refugees that they are welcome in our home, and we will care for them and love them, and they will be our sisters and brothers. So today, when we make faith promises, we are living and fulfilling the story of the church. We are living and fulfilling the story of our church. This is who we are. This is what we are. We read the words of Matthew 25 and say, yeah, this is us. So we give. And we give to the ministry of the church. The last church council meeting, the budget committee gave the church council a budget. Let me tell you about church budgets. They are so fun. And that was sarcastic. And it was really a bare bones budget. It was really just basically doing what we're doing, and there was nothing exciting or exotic in the budget. And the budget has a $50,000 deficit attached. There's nothing extra in the budget. It's cut right to the bone. I think the only way we can realize and say how important it is for us to fulfill the mission and ministry of the church and give to the church is to realize we have a story. That is why we are here. That is our story. It is our story for us to tell. It is our story for us to live. It is our story. It is the story we have to serve, to care for, and fulfill. This is our story. Tell the story, live the story, support the story. Amen.
Okay.
Your grandfather has a spot on his lung that you have to pass it. Yes, Ed.
Dear friend is having bypass surgery on the
7th. Okay, dear friend is having bypass surgery on the 7th. Yes.
John Henderson, former member passed away on the 7th.
John Henderson, a former member here, passed away on the 22nd, so we pray for his family. Yes. Yes, all the people visiting relatives or traveling home, pray for them. Yes.
Debbie, my niece-in-law is recovering from cancer.
Okay, Debbie, your niece-in-law is recovering from cancer. Some joys. Yesterday, soup kitchen was soup kitchen cause positive for mob yesterday. And the soup kitchen team was made up of kids from Genesis and from Emmanuel UCC in Louisville, and they served a turkey dinner. Who knew turkey was such a big thing? Other joys.
Sandy Carter's with us.
Sandy Carter is here. One of the ushers will bring it to you, and if you feel like you can make it forward. Just tell one of them. Also, raise your hand and they will bring it forward.
Thank you.
gracious and generous God, today is Stewardship Sunday. We remember your wonderful generosity to all of us. Life itself, food, people to love, and those who love us, this house of worship, and our money. Help us to be generous. May we not forget the least of these, imprisoned, hungry, those without a safe home, people with little money to spend. As we do to the least of these, we do it unto you. All that we have is yours alone, a trust, Lord, from you. Amen.
And now let us turn and face each other as we commission each other today. Let us go forth.